In this segment, we'll talk about that final bit of the direct motor pathway, and we call it the corticospinal tract. And it's called corticospinal because it starts in the cortex and it ends in the spinal cord. So the same motor neuron that started way up there in our motor cortex with our upper motor neuron has finally crossed the midline. Now it's come down to the spinal cord. We have the lateral corticospinal tract, which travels here, and it innervates, these are descending fibers, and it innervates the limbs. The ventral corticospinal tract is here. It is about half crossed and half uncrossed, and we'll talk more about that in the next slide or two, and it's going to innervate the trunk muscles, and the trunk muscle neurons live here. Limb motor neurons live here. Remember when we talked about the spinal cord and we talked about the cervical and lumbar enlargements, you have all those extra neurons that innervate the muscles of your upper extremity and your lower extremity. So it makes sense that that lateral cortical spinal tract travels here, so it's right next to its target neurons. So again, the corticospinal tracts, lateral and ventral, travel here. And they synapse then on what are called lower motor neurons, also known as alpha motor neurons. And these are great, big, beautiful motor neurons that send their axons then out through the ventral rootlets, the ventral roots, which then join with the dorsal to form the spinal nerve. And then these are all of the named nerves that we talked about when we talked about the plexis in peripheral nerves too, back in the spinal cord lecture. And so one thing I forgot to mention in the last slide that I want to catch you up with on this slide is, again, because the lateral corticospinal tract is over here, ventral here, these are the neurons for the trunk. These are the neurons for the limbs. This tract, the ventral, is about half crossed and about half uncrossed. This is because your trunk moves as a whole. I can't do half a sit-up. I can twist, but my whole trunk moves together. I can't move parts of my thorax or part of my abdomen independent because it's one unit. And so because you want it to move as a unit, you want information from both sides of your brain talking to both sides of your body. So half is crossed and half isn't. When it comes to the lateral corticospinal tract, that is totally crossed, just like your sensory systems. So sensation from my right arm is being perceived on the left side of my brain. When it comes to moving my right arm, those motor neurons are on the left side of my brain, and they cross in that pyramidal decussation at the bottom of the medulla, and then will innervate the motor neurons, the alpha motor neurons, in the spinal cord of my right spinal cord, and innervate then my right arm. So just to reiterate, lateral corticospinal tract completely crossed, left brain works right arm. Ventral corticospinal tract, trunk, both sides of my brain are talking to both sides of my body, okay? So this is getting down to the last, let me erase this part. And this is getting now down to the last part of this direct motor pathway in which we're talking about our beautiful alpha motor neurons that live here, sending their information out to the actual muscles, and those then. So it's corticospinal tract, one neuron, all the way up in motor cortex that has sent its axon, all the way down through the internal capsule, through the brainstem, partially halfway down or maybe all the way down our spinal cord to synapse on this alpha motor neuron. This alpha motor neuron now takes that information and exits through the spinal nerves and then goes out to innervate the muscles. And now I want to remind you of how this actually works, in that remember we have our beautiful alpha motor neuron coming out and innervating muscle fibers. And I want you to remember a motor unit. and that's the number of muscle fibers innervated by one alpha motor neuron. This is going to determine how fine the control is, because a ratio of one neuron to, you know, 100 muscle fibers is going to give you really fine control. One neuron to 1,000 motor fibers is going to give you kind of large, gross motion, big, broad movements, not fine control. The way that the neuron talks to, or more official, in more scientific terms, synapses with the muscle fibers is called a neuromuscular junction. And the neuromuscular junction is a very special connection between the neuron, the motor neuron in the ventral horn, and the muscle fibers out in your peripheral muscles. This is a very special relationship. Muscles need neurons. You know that if there's a damage within a nerve or within the spinal cord, that muscle will atrophy if it's not innervated. And neurons need muscles. Muscles make all kinds of growth factors and things that then influence the health and well-being of this alpha motor neuron. So it's a mutually beneficial relationship between the neuron and the motor fibers. In summary, what I really want you to remember is that efferent, of course, equals motor. That I want you to know where your upper motor neurons are. I want you to be able to describe the path of that upper neuron axon all the way through the internal capsule and brainstem and all the way down to the spinal cord. And then where do those upper motor neurons synapse? What's their target? What's a lower motor neuron? Where do the lower motor neurons live? Then what is the path that the axons of those neurons take to get out to the muscle? And then where do those lower motor neurons synapse, and what do we call it? If you know all of these things, you're going to be ready for the assessment.